Growing up, I never had a charcuterie. I didn't know what that was. What we had was a meat in a cheese tray. You know, funerals, weddings, graduations, first communions. You know, there was only two ways to start a party where I was from. You either had a bomb meat and cheese tray, or you turned on and turned up the Little River Band. That was it.
Friday night, it was late, I was walking you home. We got down to the gate and I was dreaming of the night. Would it turn out right? How to tell you, girl, I wanna build my world around you. Tell you that it's true. I wanna make you understand I'm talking about a lifetime plan.
Welcome to Wild at Home. I'm Richie, and today we are serving up a big old platter of charcuterie or meat and cheese trays, whatever you want to call it. To me, the goal is to make an impressive no-brainer. So I want to make it look like I put a ton of effort in, when really, in reality, I'm just good at curating the things together. That's my hope for my guests. Or, you know, maybe it's one of those years where there's not a lot of guests coming over and you're just in your closet, hand over fisting rolled up deli meats, waiting for 2021 to start. I'm not judging. There is difficulties in everyone's life at times like this, but charcuterie can maybe pull us out, pull us through, connect us, and see the light of meat, right? So there's really four components that we're going to break down today. The first one, a tuna tartare. The second is gonna be gravidlax. And we did gravidlax, if you remember, in episode 6, but we're gonna revisit it. And then we're gonna make like a mustard cream dip to tie it all together. We're gonna bring in, you know, olives and pickles and crackers and cheeses and have all these flavors bouncing back and forth and playing with each other. That's the goal of charcuterie. So let's jump into the tuna tartare and we'll push the rest of this to the side for now. Tuna tartare. What do I want to talk about in tuna tartare? I should have prepped some of this stuff. Okay, so tuna tartare is surprisingly easy to do for the level of flavor that it provides. Basically, we're going to cut up the tuna. We're going to add some really key elements. This is sort of an Asian influenced flavor, and then we're gonna mix it all up, put it in the fridge, let it set. First thing I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna cut up this nice, beautiful tuna loin. Tuna is very delicate. It does break apart really easily. So when you're cutting, you're gonna want a really nice sharp knife. I'm using a fillet knife today. This is from our friends actually over at Bubba Knives. We're just gonna cube these into little bite-sized pieces. And we're just gonna transfer this gently to a bowl. Clean as you go. Next thing we're gonna do is cut up our scallions and our jalapeno cross chop. I don't want a big, huge bite of jalapeno. I just want it to be blended in nicely, so really take your time to mince. Don't rub your eyes when you're done. And you're gonna kind of rough chop your cilantro. A little more than a rough chop. I would kind of make it a fine, medium chop. We're gonna peel a little bit of ginger here. It's just such a little amount, because ginger is strong. It's gonna go a long ways. All right, ginger. Adios. So then we're gonna just basically mix in the rest of these liquid ingredients with this and mix it all together. So soy, rice wine vinegar, sesame seed oil, sesame toasted, and then of course a little mayo. And then we're gonna mix it up real nice. So good, you guys. So good. So I'm not gonna add the avocado until the very end. The reason is that avocado can get really mushy really fast. And I don't want to overmix this. And then we'll come back to it and we'll add it at the very end. We're gonna add our sauce. Gently, gently fold it in. Give it a little taste-a-roon. You really can't beat that, man. Put it in the avocado. You fold gently, like I said. I don't want to mush the avocado up.
What are you doing?
Hello. Do you want to try this?
No.
Oh.
Does this have all my favorite flavors in it?
Let me guess. It's truly really good.
So it's tuna.
Tuna.
No, oh no. This probably is my nightmare bowl, right?
It's my heaven bowl, it's so good.
We are complete opposites, aren't we?
Everybody knows that by now.
They probably do.
Sneaking Halloween candy?
These are my favorite.
Poppers are the most disgusting candy ever created by man. It's like eating teeth covered in chocolate.
I love them.
It's disgusting.
They remind me of eating chalk.
Get out of here with that. We are literally gonna mix a bunch of stuff together in a bowl and not. You can do a blindfolded if you want. We're gonna use a creme fraiche or a yogurt or sour cream, whole grain mustard, like an English mustard, brown sugar and white wine vinegar, some dill, chopped dill, finely chopped, and then cat's favorite, capers. A little heavy in the dill. I'll make a note to myself to reduce the amount of dill. Too much dill. We'll adjust the recipe, you guys. Let's see how we did. Here we go. Fixed it. Okay, bingo. Put this away for another day. Moving along, everyone. Grab locks. Probably the co-star to tuna tartare. I know it rhymes. I know. All right, so we're gonna put this spice mixture into this bowl.
Yeah.
Now take your wand, cast a Gravadlix spell. Perfect. Crush it up.
Here it goes.
Very good. Kind of rub it around a little bit. And then you add your salt and sugar. And then you toss it around. About half it underneath the fish. And then we're gonna put the other half on top. Be much less near the tail piece because it is much thinner. And then you can layer your dill.
Oh, it's very pretty.
And then I'm just gonna put a lid on this and put it in the fridge. So fast forward about one day, 24 to 36 hours or so is where I like to pull my Gravadlox out of its curing process. It's lost a lot of its water and it's ready to slice. Slicing 101 for your Gravadlox. The goal with Gravadlox is to get as thin as you possibly can. If you're just starting this, it is going to be very difficult to do that. Just concentrate on not tearing the flesh too much and getting it as thin as you can. Keep your knife kind of wet. That's really gonna help. So you're gonna start just above, and then when you get down to the skin, you're just gonna kind of pull it back like that. Slice it off. So you can see through it kind of, it's a little translucent. Nice low angle. Long strokes, try not to tear too much, and then slice down and through. Wet your knife. Charcuterie is kind of like this canvas, and you're like the painter, and all these meats and cheeses are your paint. You're like the Bob Ross, right? You're like the Bob Ross of charcuterie, and you want to make happy little meats. A little happy meat here, a little happy meat there. Little dollop of blue, a dip, you know, a tree, a bush, all those things on your canvas, and then you eat them. It's delicious. I'm gonna put these back in the fridge to set up. Now comes arguably the most fun part of a charcuterie board is the assembly, right? To do that, we're going to purchase a bunch of delicious things from your local deli. Let's do it. First charcuterie board. I was at a restaurant called Gasthaus. It's a very German restaurant in Minneapolis with my friends. It was a bachelor party. And I had never seen a charcuterie board. And we were all laughing and having a good time around this giant, big, long table. And I remember out from the back of the kitchen comes this giant tray of food stacked high. And obviously the meats and the cheeses and breads. I couldn't believe it. And it just dropped down to the center of me and my friends. And I felt like I knew for the first time the love a parent has for their firstborn child. It was intense and it was beautiful, I probably shed some tears. It was a moving moment in my life. There is my version of a charcuterie board. It's a nice fancy meat tray. All right guys, this was charcuterie board. This was the Midwest meat tray. It's so much fun to do. It's all about thoughtful assembly. You know, even if you're not good at slicing grommet lox, throw it all on a platter. It's beautiful. It speaks for itself. A big thanks to our fishermen for catching the albacore tuna, for catching our coho. Without them, this doesn't exist. Without you members, they don't exist. And it is just a wonderful, beautiful relationship to have and pay tribute to this time of year when we're really kind of reflecting on a whole year that has been crazy and the more partnerships and mutualistic things that we can do together as a community, the better we feel. And that's what we're about. If you're just tuning in for maybe the first or second time, you want to know more about what we do, sickofsalmonshares.com is the website to go to learn about what we are all about, what our community does, and how we bring incredible responsibly harvested fish right to your doorstep every month. It's a no-brainer. It's really wonderful. And then a promo code if you want, it's Wild Home. It's $25 off your first month's share, gift from me to you. And you know, happy holidays, enjoy your families. Thanks for tuning in over the last few months of Wild at Home. And we will be back next year, 2021, with an incredible and exciting lineup. I don't know what any of it's gonna be yet, but we will figure it out together. Like we always do. Until then, happy holidays, happy charcuterie, and stay wild.